Good morning, everyone, and welcome. I'm Bob Zimmer, I'm president of the University of Chicago. Before we get into the heart of the announcement this morning, I thought I would just say a few words of background about the University of Chicago role in today's event. This event and announcement really sits at the confluence of two very important themes of the development of the university. First, the university's longstanding connection to national labs, which now, of course, include both Argonne National Laboratory and Fermilab. The university's work during the Manhattan Project, led by Enrico Fermi, was something that led to the establishment of Argonne, which was the first national laboratory. It's been operated in one form or another in cooperation with the University of Chicago since that time. So that's one major threat for today. The other one is the building that we're in, which is the University of Chicago Polsky Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation. This is a relatively new effort by the university. Its name, I think, is self-explanatory. The background is that it was a very successful entrepreneurship program in the Booth School of Business. And a few years ago, we made the decision through the support and help of Michael Polsky to take that extremely successful effort that had existed within the Booth School and to expand that effort to the whole university and the affiliated laboratories, which include Argonne, Fermilab, and now the Marine Biological Laboratory in Woods Hole. So this is a relatively new effort. It's been very exciting. It's bringing together, as I say, science, technology, and other sort of work together with the entrepreneurship efforts of the Booth School of Business and creating a very exciting environment. The one other aspect I would mention about this is that this is also open to individuals from the community, from the south side of Chicago and beyond, who do not necessarily have any affiliation with the university. And so this also becomes a major effort in terms of enhancing the communities on the south side, of which we are a proud member. So with that background, I'm going to turn the floor over to Paul Kerns, who is the interim director of Argonne National Laboratory.
Thank you very much, Bob. Do appreciate it. Thank you. Let me extend a special thanks to President Zimmer, as well as John Flavin, the Associate Vice President of Entrepreneurship and Innovation, the University of Chicago, for hosting us here today at the Polsky Center. On behalf of the Director of Chain Reaction Innovations, Andreas Roloff, and our entire lab team, we're glad that all of you could be here as well. So thank you for being here today. Chain Reaction Innovations represents a new direction for Argonne in meeting urgent challenges in energy. We are pleased to open the doors to the laboratory to a very impressive group of innovators. It's my privilege this morning to introduce the speakers, this morning's speakers. And Ernest Moniz has served as the U.S. Secretary of Energy since May 2013. Throughout his tenure, Secretary Moniz has advocated new ways for the Department of Energy and its national laboratories to support development of new technologies and create lasting benefits for society. We at Argonne thank Secretary Moniz for the great leadership he has provided and all that he has done to accelerate innovation in energy, and are very pleased that he could be here today to introduce these entrepreneurs. We are also pleased to have with us today U.S. Senator Dick Durbin. My colleagues and I appreciate the time and the investment Senator Durbin has made in getting to know Argonne, its people, its facilities, and the great science we do, and also assisting us to bring new life programs like the chain reactions to the laboratory. Senator Durbin is our state senior senator, having served since 1996. He is the assistant Democratic leader, the second highest ranking position among Senate Democrats. And he sits on the Senate Judiciary, Appropriations, and Rules Committees. He is the ranking member of the Judiciary's Committee Subcommittee on the Constitution and the Appropriations Committee Defense Subcommittee. Joining us also is U.S. Congressman Bill Foster, who's proud to say he's the only physicist in Congress. That credential and his former career at Fermilab give the Congressman unique insights into our priorities goals, opportunities, and needs at the laboratory. We are very grateful for his ongoing support. Congressman Foster has served in the U.S. House of Representatives since 2008. In addition to his position on the Committee on Science, Space, and Technology, he has also served on the Committee on Financial Services. In addition to the Senator and Congressman, I want to thank a member of Congress, Congressman Bobby Rush's staff, Eunice Suleiman, who's here today, for joining us, and appreciate his representation and certainly Congressman Rush's support for the laboratory as well. And finally, here this morning is Eric Isaacs of the University of Chicago, with which the Department of Energy contracts to manage Argonne. Dr. Isaacs assumed the role of Executive Vice President for Research, Innovation, and National Laboratories this year. Dr. Isaacs served as the University Provost from 2014 to 2016 after serving for 5 years as the Director of Argonne. Argonne is grateful to the Executive Vice President, President Zimmer, and the University of Chicago Argonne Board of Governors for their vision and guidance in building programs like Chain Reaction Innovations that enable us to meet societal challenges in exciting new ways, more impactful ways. Now please join me in welcoming Ernest Moniz, the U.S. Secretary of Energy, to announce the members of the first Chain Reaction Innovation Cohort. Secretary, please.
Well, thank you, Paul, and I'll soon get to thanking others here in the audience, but first I want to say that today is the, it's not an anniversary, it's the pre-anniversary. It's 1 month to go today. Today is December the 20th, and I can think of, it's great to be here in Chicago on this for this milestone, and not just because it's anywhere other than D.C. It's actually good to be in Chicago and Illinois because we have so much that we do here in the state and the city. Obviously, the two labs have already been mentioned, and I'll say a bit more about that in a second. But it's great to be here again with great partners, the partners from the University of Chicago, President Zimmer, Vice President, there he is, Eric Isaacs, who we used to torment as a lab director, but he then decided to get out of the line of fire. Paul Kerns, but of course also the congressional delegation. Senator Durbin is, you all know it, but an enormous champion for research, for innovation, and for the laboratories. He's, I think, you're still, I believe, the co-chair of the Senate National Labs Caucus, for example, and he's helped us put together significant events on the Hill, Lab Days on the Hill, which I think have been opening eyes in terms of what goes on at our national labs. Bill Foster is a constant visitor to those Lab Days. He can't stay away as the only physicist in Congress, and I say a great friend and somebody who uses his science background effectively in Congress. And although again not here, Bobby Rush was mentioned, and I will just say that Congressman Rush and I have conspired to start something called Minorities in Energy at DOE. It's been great, and I had the pleasure of recording a little video birthday greeting for him a few weeks ago. I also want to acknowledge the Chain Reaction folks, Araj Haque, co-founder. Is he here? Yes, there, back in the back. Okay, and again, some of your colleagues who are not here today, I guess, but were instrumental, Mr. Ulrich, Mr. Roloffs, for example. But yeah, I said, you know, before getting into the main event, I mean, in terms of the entrepreneurs. Who I suspect look like these spiffy people here in that row, without having met them yet, but they look suspiciously like entrepreneurs. And kind of except that they're dressed in a different way than I bet they usually are. But anyway, being here again, it's really terrific. First of all, I would say that You now have Tayo Epstein, who used to be my Brookline, Massachusetts neighbor, and he's done magic for the Red Sox and the Cubs. But I do want to remind you, we've won three times already in this century, I think we need to square off in the next World Series with the Cubs and the Red Sox. But also here in Illinois and in Chicago, we have so much going on. I'll just say in a couple of areas. One is more to the south, but in fact, Senator Durbin, I think last week, was part of the announcement of $10 million to advance carbon sequestration science and the Mount Simon formation. And in a few months, probably in April, ADM will be turning on their big ethanol plant with carbon capture using that formation. And that was really exciting. And I've worked with Senator Durbin in this area now for a few years as well. Also here, obviously, with the lab, with Argonne, we all know the famous battery hub, J. Caesar, which has already had substantial impact and will have more. But also today, I'm going to do a mini announcement before the big announcement. The mini announcement is that we are now funding a new project at Argonne that will take the expertise developed in the battery hub in roll-to-roll manufacturing and now have that applied to desalination technologies, because Argonne has also been very important for us in the water, energy and water, as has the partnership of Argonne, the University of Chicago, Ben Gurion University in Israel in terms of these water technologies, working with the city as well, and current in terms of the big water focus here. So it's another exciting area that not maybe today, but I did want to say that we have a $500,000 project that we're going to start that can go into this link in terms of the energy water nexus. And finally, I just want to add another thing for Senator Durbin in particular, because Senator Durbin, as I said, is been so committed across the board in terms of innovation and research and labs, et cetera. But I know you have a very strong interest in the biomedical arena. And I just want to say that, again, Argonne, along with Oak Ridge and Livermore in particular, are part of the new next generation high-performance computing, the Coral architecture. That in turn is now central to the cancer moonshot. Bringing high performance computing and big data analytics and machine learning to bear on cancer is going to be another contribution that our labs and Argonne in particular will be part of. And in the Cures Act, I don't know if you saw this one sentence of the Cures Act, but it was very important for us, and it only cost us 25 million barrels of oil. The Cures Act specifically calls out the use of high-performance computing and other unique technologies of our national laboratories to work with NIH in precision medicine. And so, it's great, just across the board, doing all this stuff. But anyway, that was prologue. Today, we're here to really celebrate this new step forward in terms of innovation, introduce the entrepreneurial teams. But I just want to say that very broadly, last year in Paris, obviously the Paris Accord was enormously important. The world committing to move forward to lower carbon. But I don't want to forget, at the beginning of the Paris meeting, innovation was put at the heart of addressing the challenge. And so this commitment to innovation is the secret sauce. It's going to help us and everyone resolve the challenge of climate and energy security as well. It's also going to contribute to our economy, and that's where I think what we're talking about here today is going to be so important, as you all produce fabulous technologies that are going to create enormous export markets for the United States in no time at all, in 2 years. So the focus on labs, as was said by Paul, we've also made that in the last few years a very, very big emphasis. And what I want to say is that I think whether it's Argonne or our other national laboratories, and often in association with universities, and this is a case where we have a very close association, obviously, with the university, that this is the secret to innovation, and I think it's going to be a secret to regional innovation. We need to build up innovation in the various regions of our country. Here in this area, you got a big head start compared to some other areas, but I think this is a key theme, and again, one of the reasons why I'm excited about what we are here to celebrate. Now, CRI is our second lab embedded entrepreneurship node, if you like, supported by our Office of Energy Efficiency and Renewable Energy, inspired in many ways by the Cyclotron Road pilot program at Lawrence Berkeley Lab that we started a couple of years ago. So the idea, I think you all know this, but just very briefly, the idea is to enable startups to leverage the tools that we have around our national labs, manufacturing hubs, access to companies, big companies, research universities, again, innovation incubators, accelerators, and all of the ecosystem that one needs to succeed in this business. So CRI offers, innovators with energy-based, complex science-based ideas a home for up to 2 years to have the opportunity to develop and scale their technologies to a level that can capture investor and consumer interest while receiving mentorship and training and vital technical interactions as they are called upon. So partnerships with the Polsky Center here for Entrepreneurship and Innovation, also Purdue University's Foundry, will help CRI participants develop business plans and strategies, conduct market research, find long-term financing and commercial partners, in addition to their interaction with the technical surroundings of a university and a national laboratory. We think embedding top technical talent in a world-class R&D facility like Argonne, while maintaining a focus on entrepreneurial endeavors, will really help create a new generation of energy entrepreneurs. And so, we're very, very excited about that, and we'll make all the tools of the laboratory available to them. So today, we're announcing the first cohort of entrepreneurs and the partners who will help them through CRI. More than 100 innovators from 22 states applied to CRI for this first cohort, and four projects have been selected. And I'll name the winners and the projects. So Felipe Gomez del Campo, you want to stand up? founder and CEO of FGC Plasma Solutions, a Cleveland-based company developing a novel fuel injector for jet engines and gas turbines to better control combustion and therefore emissions. Thank you. Ian Hamilton from Indiana. Founder and CEO of Atlas Energy Systems, an energy development company focused on the conversion of spent nuclear fuel into usable energy. Thank you. Chad Mason, from Michigan, working to enable new applications for electrochemical devices by eliminating the need for electrolytes to act as electronic insulators. These new applications can include batteries, fuel cells, electrolyzers, chemical production. So thank you. And finally, a duo from Colorado, Tyler Huggins and Justin Whiteley. And they are co-founders of Energy LLC, a company focusing on advanced carbon material synthesis through biofabrication. So again, congratulations to all of you together, and I know you're going to enjoy the next couple of years immensely, and hopefully they're going to be extremely productive for you, for the region, for the country, and frankly, for solving the energy challenges in the world. So thank you very much.
Thanks for allowing me to say a few words this morning. I'm honored to be joined by my colleague, Bill Foster. I want to also take an opportunity to thank Peter Littlewood for the hard work that he put in as Argonne director. He was instrumental in helping to position the advanced photon source for its upgrade and launch this exciting new initiative that we're talking about today. Congratulations to Paul Kerns for being named interim director. And let me, while we're giving congratulations out, say a word or two about the previous speaker. Secretary Ernest Moniz has done so many things in his brief tenure as Secretary of Energy, but the one that I feel so strongly about was his instrumental work in securing the Iran nuclear agreement. Were it not for this secretary and his credibility on an international basis, it would not have happened. I say that as a person who was responsible for counting the votes in the United States Senate, and I know at crucial moments when questions, tough questions were being asked, hard questions being asked, charges were being made, fake news was flying, there was one person we could go to who was give us a credible answer that brought the votes around that were critical for us to put 42 senators together in his corner. As a result of that amazing, incredible scientific work and political work, we are a safer world. And that is a great tribute to you, Secretary Moniz. Thank you so much for your service. I've got a great speech here about how important Argonne is, but I think most people in the room believe it. So I'm not going to go into any detail. I'm going to thank Jasmine Hunt on my staff, my PhD, new mom, for coming out here today to Chicago. But I also want to say a word about something that Secretary Moniz alluded to. He's not only a great secretary, he gave away a free breakfast to a member of the Congress, myself, and I appreciated that very much. And we got into a conversation there about research and innovation, and I talked about biomedical research and meeting with Dr. Collins at NIH, and I talked about Alzheimer's, one diagnosis every 67 seconds in the United States, and how much we have to do and this and that, and the Human Genome Project. And you were quick to tell me that when it came to the Human Genome Project, the Department of Energy played a critical role. I didn't forget. Didn't forget it. And went back and said, it's not only going to be the American Cures Act, it'll be the American Innovation Act. We are going to dedicate ourselves, and I hope we can pull it off, to 5% real growth in the budget of key agencies like the Department of Energy. I believe it's an investment in our future and one that'll pay off handsomely. So we're working on that. We managed to pass one version of it in the Senate. As usual, Bill, not your fault because you're in the minority, but as usual, it didn't quite cross the finish line in the House, but we still have a lot more to do. That was the Energy Policy Modernization Act, and we're hoping to return to it soon. Let me conclude by saying this. I think this marriage of public and private sector innovation is critical. The man that this particular setting is named after, Michael Polsky, has proven that. Here is another great immigrant to America who has made a difference, not only in the business world, but now in academia and in research. And thank goodness he has. For him to create this setting where we can bring together these terrific young minds who want to come up with the next generation of products and services to keep America at the front of the parade is the reason we're all here today. It's an honor to be with you. Thank you.
Well, thanks to all of you for inviting me here today. And before I get started, I want to echo Dick Durbin's tribute to Senator Secretary Moniz's work in the Iran nuclear deal. You know, I think as being the only PhD scientist in Congress, I think I had 13 classified briefings on the nuts and bolts of the agreement when it was up for, you know, up for review by Congress. And the degree to which Ernie has engaged the expertise at the full set of national laboratories is something that was just tremendous and necessary to get that agreement across the finish line. When it became time, for example, to specify exactly how Iran had to constrain the construction of its heavy water reactor so it could never get used to make large amounts of weapons-grade plutonium, the experts that he tapped into there were at Argonne National Lab. Anyway, I was told by Ernie, actually, that it was all right for me to take off my name tag, that because for those of you who don't know me, I'm Congressman Bill Foster. It's my honor to represent the 11th District of Illinois, which includes the northern portion of Argonne. But before I became a congressman, I was a scientist and a businessman. When I was 19 years old, my little brother and I founded a company in our basement manufacturing microprocessor-based theater lighting systems. And when we started our company, it was a simpler time. When all you needed to make a state-of-the-art product was, you know, a good public education, a soldering iron, catalogs of electronic parts, and in our case, $500 from my parents. But that company we started now provides more than 1,000 manufacturing jobs, good manufacturing jobs with good pay and good benefits, and we've kept those manufacturing jobs in the Midwest, which is something I'm very proud of. We did that by treating our workers fairly and maintaining our technical edge. And that's what it's about today. And so I then went on to get my PhD in high energy particle physics from Harvard and worked for 23 years at Fermi National Accelerator Laboratory, another Department of Energy laboratory here in Illinois. And I did that for 23 years before I ran for Congress. There I was part of the team that discovered the top quark, the heaviest known form of matter, a scientific discovery from the prairies of Illinois that will live on in the science textbooks forever. That discovery was a huge team effort, and one required hundreds of scientists, engineers, and state-of-the-art technologies from DOE national labs and universities from around the country and around the world. And that is how the world has changed, and since we started our company 40 years ago. While some great companies can still be started today by a couple of brothers or sisters in their parents' basement, many of the great innovations today are so scientifically and technically complex that they can only be proven out with the resources available at places like our great taxpayer-supported laboratories run by the Department of Energy of the United States. And since I'm now not only physicist in Congress, but the only PhD scientist of any kind, so small correction there. You can either applaud or cry, I'm not sure what's appropriate, but I know firsthand the value of support like this for our young scientists and aspiring business people. And a place like Argonne National Laboratory is an ideal location to nourish the young minds in their research. For over 70 years, Argonne has been at the forefront of scientific innovation and research. Argonne is the home to Mira, one of the world's fastest supercomputers, and is also the home of the advanced photon source, the brightest X-ray source in the Western Hemisphere. Ongoing updates to these and other user facilities at the lab will help maintain U.S. leadership in scientific discovery and will train the next generation of scientists. Everyone here knows that it's imperative that we continue to give scientists, both young and old, the support they need to ensure our country's leadership in scientific research and innovation. And it's an honor as a scientist to represent a national laboratory that has been and will continue to be at the forefront of scientific discovery. But what we're celebrating today is the transfer of that great technology to the next generation of entrepreneurs. Here in Illinois, we're cultivating a unique ecosystem of support for scientists and entrepreneurs, and Argonne's Chain Reaction Initiatives Innovations Program is perfectly positioned to make this ecosystem even more robust. Initiatives like this are what keep me optimistic about the future of our country and the scientific and economic progress in Illinois, the United States, and around the world. I look forward to following this very promising cohort over the next 2 years. I wish them the best of luck, and I want them to know that they have friends in Congress, and that includes at least one who is very envious of the technical resources that you will have at your disposal. Thank you all.
So it's my distinct honor to stand up here, to follow President of the University, to follow Director of a Lab, Secretary of Energy, a Senator and a Congressman, to close this session out. So I appreciate everything that's been said. I do want to thank everybody. I want to thank Congressman Foster. I mean, it is remarkable to be able to work with a physicist in Congress. You just immediately understand the issues around sciences and innovation. I want to thank Senator Durbin for many years being a great partner. I don't think there's any other laboratories, Argonne and Fermi, in the country, maybe except Oak Ridge, that has the kind of relationship that we've enjoyed over the years with you, Senator. And it's been a really important relationship to boost the confidence, if you will, of the labs to be able to do great things. I particularly want to thank Secretary Moniz, also a physicist. I was a graduate student at MIT and had you as a TA in my electricity and magnetism. I learned Jackson from you, by the way. But I do want... That's off the record. I do want to say that, you know, and I haven't had personally the experience, but running an agency for the U.S. government is a real big challenge, and particularly the Department of Energy. It's not always considered the first agency out in the field, and I think what the Secretary has done is remarkable. In many ways, we've already heard about the Iran deal, but I do want to highlight that his work to transform the agency to really bring innovation in a way that it just hasn't been done before. Your vision, your willingness to try innovative programs have really lowered the bar, in particular for the department's national laboratories, to try new things like we're hearing today. It's really been remarkable, this idea of commercialization, opening up the national labs in a way which is really going to be important in the coming years for energy, but also in general for getting science out into the open world. Enough's been said about chain reaction. I just wanted to make one point about it, that, and you can ask our young entrepreneurs here, if you think about what it takes to try to get a business to go from an idea or a benchtop, a lab benchtop, to something which is a company, it's remarkably hard. It's a remarkably hard process. It doesn't just happen. Most people who are scientists, physicists, don't really know what it takes to actually create a business. So the idea that we would open up the national labs as part of that ecosystem to prove in ideas, a concept is important, but unless you can prove it, reduce the risk in it, really do things with it to make it possible for a real business formation, it's going to go nowhere. So this idea of opening the labs up through programs like CRI, as you mentioned, is really important. In particular, think of the resources now being made available. You've got one of the fastest supercomputers in the world. You've got facilities for validating manufacturing processes sitting at the lab that have been used in effective ways, but never this way before. So I think this is a remarkable and really important program for individual innovators and creators to get in and try something new. So finally, I'd just like to say that, you know, we're really excited with this particular program. As President Zimmer said, the convergence of the work that's going on at universities, the work, particularly University of Chicago through Polsky Center, the work that's going on out at Argonne National Labs, at Fermi National Labs, and many of our colleagues around the Chicago and regional area is really starting to transform the ecosystem, the innovation ecosystem. So again, thank you all for coming. We really appreciate the work that DOE's done. We appreciate what Argonne has been doing to really move ideas into real businesses. So with that, I will ask Chris Kramer to come up. Thank you.
I know we've got some members of the media here, so it's an opportunity for some questions. Does anybody have any questions? Yes. Hang on a second. Give me a microphone there so everybody can hear.
Great. David Unger with Midwest Energy News. This is probably a question for Paul or Secretary Moniz. I'm wondering, we've heard a lot about how this opportunity benefits these entrepreneurs. How might it benefit the scientists already working at Argonne to have interactions with these entrepreneurs? And is there any danger in terms of their being not necessarily a distraction, but sort of having to divide resources more in terms of having this extra workload, or how is that going to be managed?
Let me respond initially, and perhaps the Secretary might want to add some comments. The prospect of working with young entrepreneurs, young innovators, has been very well received at the laboratory. A lot of excitement, a lot of interest in really joining minds and working on some new ideas. One of the nice things about this program, it brings new ideas into the laboratory, some fresh minds as well, some new energy, if you will, associated with that. And it's actually very exciting. And so the researchers have quickly identified areas that they would like to collaborate with these entrepreneurs to really help advance their technologies, their ideas further. So it's been very well received. I think it's going to bring a new energy to the laboratory and really help us to understand more effectively how to work with startup companies and how to more effectively move technology from the laboratory into industry. So it's lots of benefits for the laboratory.
So I certainly endorse what Paul said. I'll come back to it specifically, but let me first make a broader comment that this is one of the directions that we have taken, as Eric referred to, in terms of trying to increase our batting average in terms of getting the very exciting work in the laboratories out, and now also bringing some work out into the laboratories, and they change each other. Frankly, I'll make a bet that, like, I won't say all. I'll leave them a little out. But at least three of the four projects will end up looking incredibly different in terms of what they're doing and what their market targets are going to be at the end of this as these interactions take place. But I'll just give one other example of a new direction that we have taken, different from this one, which is that we have established from our applied energy programs a fund which matches, again, laboratories and typically small companies in matching fund projects that come in. This is, by the way, a very quick response to a direction from Congress in 2005 to establish this fund. we've made our first set of awards, and I just think that it's creating more fertile ground, as I think Eric said. In effect, it's not always easy at the bench or at the entrepreneurial level to actually understand what a market is, and how you get there. So we have to bring a lot of threads together to accelerate innovation that actually gets into the marketplace. And frankly, we need it. In the clean energy space, there was a report about a month ago from the International Finance Corporation and the World Bank. And just in 21 emerging economies, post-Paris, their estimate is conservatively a $23 trillion market to 2030, just in those 21 emerging economies. So if nothing else, we don't want to lose our innovation edge in terms of getting out and leading and intersecting that economy. And that's why, and again, I'm sorry, I keep going on, but the last point I'll make, many things have to fit together. And I can ask my colleagues here as well. You see it in some of the things we talked about today, the focus also on advanced manufacturing technologies. These entrepreneurs may end up going straight into that and finding that some of these advanced manufacturing technologies are going to be what they need to have a competitive edge in their market. So it's a multi-pronged attack, and it's all about, frankly, it is ultimately about jobs, prosperity, innovation, and meeting our economic, environmental, and national security goals.
Mr. Secretary, yeah. You mentioned your waning days in Washington. So what are your thoughts on the new administration, and particularly the proposed successor in your position, who has said in the past that he wants to abolish the department? And what are your thoughts on the future of the department, and by extension, Argonne?
I'll say a few words, but maybe my colleagues from Congress would like to add
add a few words to this. Look, all I can say is that, first of all, with regard to the Department of Energy, this is nothing new. This is nothing post-election. This goes back, Eric knows this from when he was lab director already, when we talked about institutionalizing some of the progress we've made, including the progress with regard to how we work with the laboratories. What I said right from the beginning is, you want to institutionalize something, show value added. That's how you institutionalize something, by having value added, and then, you know, the next team comes in what is always a relay race in these in the administration, and they see what works, and, you know, as a rule, that's your best not defense, it's your best offense in terms of continuing these things. So, look, I've already spoken with Governor Perry, and Governor Perry, I think, is very intent on doing a good job. I've already talked with him about the special role of the National Laboratories, that our job at DOE in providing part of the backbone of American science, in advancing clean energy technology, in advancing nuclear security from the deterrent to making safe nuclear materials, by the way, to providing also nuclear propulsion for the Navy, to cleaning up the Cold War legacy. Every job we do is fundamentally a science and technology job. DOE, I'll say it now since I'm leaving, DOE is a science and technology powerhouse in this country, and people should not forget that. And the special asset we have for applying science and technology to all those missions is our system of 17 national laboratories. It is unique in the world. It is unparalleled. And it is the job of the Secretary of Energy to nurture and steward that system in the service of all of these.
Okay, just one follow-up. What was Governor Perry's response to your...
His response is that he's obviously in a mode of trying to absorb a lot of information about the department. He's not, you know, the department, be blunt, is not well understood generally, because we have so many different missions that everybody seems to know one part of it, all right? So the governor certainly understands the breadth of the missions. He understands the science and technology base. He understands the national laboratory needs. Now, obviously, it's going to be up to him and the administration to assemble a team, because it's not one person. It's a leadership team that can handle, address, advance all of these various missions and the science and technology underpinnings on which success rests. Dick or you know, no?
We've got time for like maybe two more questions. Two more questions.
Thank you. Dan Weissman, WBEZ. So just to expand on that question further, and this is probably for Representative Foster or Senator Durbin, but Secretary Moniz, obviously, you've kind of said your piece on this. But there will be a partnership essentially, right, between the executive administration and Congress to decide on appropriations for the Energy Department, for the national labs. And what are some possible timetables? I mean, in a kind of, if the Congress and the new administration were to decide that their priorities lay elsewhere, and that they would prefer to withdraw resources from the research funded by the Department of Energy, what would be the timetable? How quickly might we see consequences at the national labs? How much is subject to continuing appropriations? What's year to year? How far are things locked in?
So I do think this is my friends from Congress need to really help come up and discuss this one. But look, first of all, I cannot predict what the future in the administration and the Congress holds. But all I can say again, it goes back to my institutionalization remark. The Department of Energy is showing its value in addressing fundamental issues. By the way, we've talked about, as an aside, we've talked about, I think, I think we have a very, very strong relationship as to how the laboratories and the department are working together. This is not exactly your question, but I'll come back to it. Let me say, for example, now I think 3 years in a row, we had something called the Big Ideas Summit. And this is the labs coming in to brainstorm with the department, not about how are they going to execute a project, what are the kinds of directions we should go in. So they are, you know, they're part and parcel of the strategic planning in ways that was not the case even a few years ago. In a similar vein, I'll just go similar vein, I don't believe there's been a stronger Department of Energy, Department of Defense relationship in terms of the nuclear security agenda. Those are relationships that need to be preserved. I think they will be. They will show value. And then the resources will follow. That's my view. And I think, as Senator Durbin said, I think that budgets may be robust, they may be strained, et cetera, but I don't think this country is going to turn away from innovation, from research, from science. And I think the Department of Energy programs, as with NSF and NIH, et cetera, I think they have to remain priorities. But I don't know, again, Senator Durbin, you want to comment on that?
I've been begging for help. let me say at the outset, what I'm about to say represents my views, not the Secretary's or the University of Chicago or Argonne or anyone. First, we are all hoping that many of these people who are being named, once they get inside, will have a different view and see the magnitude of the challenge and the magnitude of their responsibility. Having said that, last week I was in Decatur, Illinois, and we did announce about a $9 million grant for carbon capture and sequestration. Why did we spend $9 million? Because we happen to believe that emissions going into the atmosphere are not good for us as humans or Mother Earth. If you reject that premise, that was a $9 million waste of money. Why in the world do we want to capture any emissions? I happen to believe it's critical that we do. But the decision will be made by the new administration about whether this is a priority. Their political party is the only major political party in the world today that denies climate change. That's the premise here. So we've been pretty friendly, and I'm hopeful, but the reality is there are going to be some threshold questions that have to be answered about the new administration and their new energy policy. Many things will be obvious that we should continue and put investment in. Others clearly are going to be controversial, and in some respects already have been.
And so what would be the timetable if the policy decisions reject that premise and policy decisions follow? What are the possible timetables in a kind of worst-case scenario where there's an initiative to withdraw, to change priorities? How quickly can that happen?
Well, the new president submits a new budget in a matter of months. The new president also inherits a continuing resolution. He has 5 or 6 months left in this fiscal year that is under his control in negotiating with Congress, so he can have an even faster impact before October 1st of next year. We could see it. Who knows at this point? We don't even know all the players, let alone the strategies.
I'll just say one thing. I really hope that the incoming administration, particularly in regards to managing the scientific programs, doesn't come in as a bull in a china shop. They should be very aware of the asymmetry between the time it takes to create a scientific program and the time it takes to destroy one. You can destroy a scientific initiative that has been decades in the making in a single budget cycle. And I hope they're very cognizant of that, to aim carefully before they shoot.
Thank you.